Alrighty, hello again, everyone, and welcome to it. It's the Friday video interview edition of the Daily Caller podcast, or the middle of the audio version if you subscribe on iTunes and all that good things. Either way, the show is on and going now. I'm Derek Hunter. I am your host. Thank you for listening, tuning in, telling a friend, spreading the word, and all that good stuff. As we do every week, we drag somebody from their life into our world and pick their brains. They're always much better looking, much funnier, and more successful than we are, and this week is no different. We're joined by Lee Smith, author of the new book, The Plot Against the President, The True Story of How Congressman Devin Nunes Uncovered the Biggest Political Scandal in U.S. History. Lee, welcome to the program.
Thank you so much for inviting me, and hi to listeners and viewers and everyone in your audience.
It's
a real pleasure to be here.
No swiveling. I'll do the swiveling.
Okay. All right.
Before we get into the book, I want to talk a little bit about how you came to write the book. Yeah. You've been in journalism for 30 years. You write at Real Clear Investigations. You write at The Federalist. You write at Tablet Magazine. You've been doing this a very long time. This is a story that seemed, you know, it was certainly covered. It seemed like at the time, but turns out not particularly well. What made you decide that not only this book had to be written, but that Devin Nunes, because he's somebody everybody knows, everybody's seen him on television, either on Fox as a guest or on MSNBC or CNN as a punching bag and a punchline and clips from Fox. But he's really the hero of the story, despite what how he's been portrayed. So before we get into the details of why that is, what made you think this is a deeper story? What made you discover there's a deeper story
here? Well, I knew there was a deeper story from the outset when this started, before the election even, in 2016. And that was because covering the Middle East, which is what I was doing at the time and still do to a certain extent, I saw how the Obama administration had marketed the Iran deal through what we now know as the echo chamber.
That Ben Rhodes described, basically,
right,
a bunch
exactly.
of dumb 20-somethings who will print anything.
Exactly. Actually, as it turns out, Rhodes was throwing a bit of a bone to the people who are really at the center of the echo chamber, and those are the older, more established journalists. He was throwing it on the 27-year-olds, as he put it, who know nothing. Actually, as it turns out, at the center of the echo chamber are the people at the big places, the big names, whether this is David Remnick, at the New Yorker, whether it's people at the New York Times or Washington Post. Anyway, I recognized the messaging that they were doing regarding Trump's ties to Russia as an echo chamber operation. It was the same outlets. It was the same people making the same sort of noise, amplified and validated in precisely the same way. It was also, I'd lived in New York for a long time. I was raised in New York. I've had Donald Trump's words ringing in my ears since I was a teenager.
Screaming at you from the front pages of the tabloids. You can't escape it.
Exactly. So there are many things that one can say about the man who is now our president. But the idea that somehow he'd been conducting secret relations with a foreign power in the most media-saturated city in world history, also under the watchful eye of the New York City Police Department, the FBI New York field office, while Mr. Trump was also working while he also owned casinos and was involved in real estate. The idea that he never came to the attention of the FBI or the police department, that they weren't looking closely, was preposterous. So I knew the story was nonsense from the outset.
So you sit down to write this. Talk a little bit about why Devin Nunes is in the subtitle, is the focus of the book, because, again, he's known sort of as a talking head and a member of Congress. But you give him credit. You know, he discovered this whole thing. How did you come to, once you're interested in the subject, once you've got the subject and the absurdity of the idea behind the allegations, it centers on Devin Nunes. How'd you get to that point?
Well, as response to the book shows, which has been overwhelming, and I would want to say surprising, but it's not. It has nothing to do with me. It's a good book, but the reason the response has been overwhelming is because people around the country recognize what Congressman Nunes did. And so watching this, watching what the congressman did, how he stepped forward starting in March 2017, identifying the fact that Obama officials had been unmasking members of the Trump transition team. When he stepped forward and did that, how many people started to attack him? I was among those, again, like a lot of people in the country, who said, that takes real courage. And again, he was not, it's not just that he was attacked on places like CNN and MSNBC and by the Washington Post and the New York Times. He did not have a whole heck of a lot of support on Capitol Hill either. Mm-hmm. He has an excellent reputation as a thoughtful, moderate Republican. The problem is that he was attacked so much, other Republicans were essentially terrorized by what the press and what political operatives were doing.
Well, yeah, the ethics complaint against him and had to recuse himself for a while.
That's right.
It was proven bogus, but he was forced to step back. The attacks on him got to be so much.
Exactly. And other people on the Hill were watching what had happened. And as much as they admired and respect him, they were worried. We saw what happened, how they ran Michael Flynn out of the White House, how they compelled then Attorney General Jeff Sessions to recuse himself. And of course, we all remember the daily, nearly hourly drumbeat of the Trump-Russia operation. Here's Russia. There's Russia. It terrified most people. Congressman Nunes stepped up. He took the heat. He believed he was right. He pressed forward, and it was an impressive thing. I am certainly not alone in looking at this and seeing how impressive it was. And I just thought, well, that's really – he's a heroic figure. And so before I figured out how I wanted to write about the entire Russiagate thing, a way to find how to tell the story, it was just, again, just being impressed by the congressman. Like millions of other Americans.
Do you think he was prepared for what came his way when he decided to be sort of the vocal opposition to the liberal narrative?
No, I think it was impossible for anyone to understand what that would look like because of the nature of the press and the nature of even political operations has changed profoundly. I mean, we see right now what's happening with the impeachment inquiry. I mean, all of these things are made up out of, well, it's nonsense, like the Steele dossier itself. So once you have nonsense at the center of it, what's built up around it is it's just absolute garbage. And the fury with which this campaign was waged, I don't think anyone saw this coming. The congressman didn't see it. I think most Americans around the country didn't see it. I think we're all still stunned. We're less surprised now seeing the impeachment inquiry. But the vehemence of the Russiagate campaign, it's astonishing still.
Let's go back now to the sort of start of this story. June 16th, 2015, Donald Trump steps on an escalator, comes down, and really angers every liberal in the country. Mm-hmm. He sort of did already when he was flirting with the idea. And in the Obama administration, they kind of had the long knives out with him with the birther stuff. But from that moment on, there's a frenzy. Mm-hmm. Not just there were people who took him seriously, but not too seriously. And one outlet that is mistakenly blamed, given credit for whatever, the actual origins of the Steele dossier is the Washington Free Beacon. I love the Washington Free Beacon. But they hired Fusion GPS to find some things out about Donald Trump. They're a very small operation, so they didn't have somebody to dedicate to it. That's been spun into this. They funded the Steele dossier. They started the Steele dossier. But talk about the evolution and the reality of this little do some research and opposition research that the Free Beacon started to this massive scam that was used by our government to spy on American citizens.
Well, the Beacon had, you're right, that brought them on, brought Fusion GPS on to do opposition research. But as we know, opposition research is a legitimate industry. Mm-hmm. I mean, people pay to have dirt dug up on their opponents.
Well, let me ask you this, because from an opposition research point of view, if you're doing opposition research against somebody running for you for city council or even for Congress here, and they've lived here and you're looking here, you can probably have a staffer do that pretty easily. Somebody like Donald Trump, who owns property around the world, a billionaire, has traveled the world, knows everybody around them. If you go to Norway and you don't speak Norwegian, you're probably going to have a hard time searching information. So you need to outsource it to a group that has the resources to reach out to somebody in Scandinavian countries who knows the language, right? That would be kind of why the Free Beacon went that route.
Right. Again, it's a large subject. The kind of research they wanted to do on Donald Trump, and we know that in October 2015, Fusion GPS brought on Nellie Orr, who's a former Russian professor of Russian history, and so she's a Russian language linguist. So it was clear that was the direction that Fusion was taking it in. We don't know exactly what the Beacon was looking at. I'll say one thing that's very important. The Beacon has made the correct point to say we had nothing to do with the dossier. It's very important that people understand what happened between a very particular period when Fusion GPS was no longer doing opposition research. The plan was to look into the Trump team's alleged possible ties to Russian organized crime figures. Might make a certain amount of sense. Again, Donald Trump has businesses in New York, and New York has a lot of an enormous Russian diaspora, one of the largest in the world. That's what Fusion was first looking at. In my book, I talk about different documents they have that shows that they were actually engaged in that kind of research, some of it focusing on Paul Manafort and focusing on other Trump advisors. The Steele dossier is something very different. The first report is dated June 20th. This has nothing to do with Russian organized crime, nor is it about opposition research. What it's about the Trump team's alleged ties to a foreign power, the Russian state. What they appear to be doing, what this appears to be, is laying the groundwork for a counterintelligence investigation. In other words, that was the purpose of the dossier. It was written to eventually obtain a warrant to spy on the Trump campaign. So just to come back to the Free Beacon for a second, opposition research is a perfectly normal thing that political campaigns do all the time. They are correct and right to say we had nothing to do with the Steele dossier, because the Steele dossier is a very, very different enterprise.
When it comes to this shift to try to start the counterintelligence investigation, there was still very few people not named Trump who believed at all that Donald Trump had a chance to become president. Why did they start this? How did it get to that point? Why would they want to spy on the Trump campaign if you think you're going to get 60% and win 47 states? Was it an ace in the hole? Was it in case during Clinton's first term, if somebody got a little lippy, they could, you know, back channel them and screw them over? Why would they care to the point that they would start this massive witch hunt?
Well, the first thing is, remember, if we go back to Watergate, Nixon was going to walk over any Democratic candidate, whether, you know, they went after Muskie at first. And then they had McGovern. So why did Nixon break into the DNC? Or why did people break into the DNC on behalf of the Nixon campaign? Mm-hmm. Because it's part of the logic of power. If you have powerful instruments to exercise your power, this is what people did. And so the Clinton campaign exercised the same power. They had the ability to get the FBI to spy on the Trump campaign. So they did. That was the first reason. The second reason is because there was one large concern the Clinton campaign had, and it wasn't about Donald Trump. The Clinton campaign was worried about the emails that Hillary Clinton had deleted. This is the essential point, right? James Comey cleared Hillary Clinton in July 2016. But the fact is, because everyone in the Obama administration had communicated with Clinton on that email, as Andy McCarthy has so elegantly written. There was no way there was ever going to be a prosecution. There was no way there was going to be an indictment. What they were concerned about was not how she mishandled classified information. They were concerned about some of these items going public, some of these emails going public. That was their big concern. With that concern, there was no way to change the message. What they needed to do was a way to dirty the messenger, saying, don't you pay attention, never you mind what these emails are about, what Hillary Clinton is doing with. The important fact here is that these emails came from Russia to benefit Donald Trump. They were worried about the Trump campaign dropping an October surprise, and that October surprise would look something like the Clinton campaign's emails. The dossier is quite specific about how the Russians are handing information to the Trump campaign. So they were trying to dirty the Trump campaign to clear the Clinton campaign.
So this entire thing is started as a prophylactic move against dirt truth coming out about Hillary Clinton.
That's a large part of it. Then they move at a later phase to their defending against an October surprise, and also they are seeking an October surprise. And again, that's the other purpose of the dossier. It's an electronic break-in. They want to break into the campaign and find something, presumably Russia-related, maybe not, to wave in front of the cameras and say, here's what we have on Donald Trump.
But, Lee, I've read the New York Times. The dossier had nothing to do with the FISA warrant. It had nothing to do with launching the investigation. Yeah. I've seen people who represented organizations that are called by three letters swear to me that they had nothing to do with it.
Yes, their problem is that they say that the investigation of the Trump campaign began July 31st, 2016. Pay no attention to the dossier. I know that we talked about this a lot in the past, but as it turns out, it had nothing to do with the investigation. It only supplemented the investigation and gave us more information. Well, as you mentioned, it was also used as evidence to obtain a warrant to spy on the Trump campaign. And as the documents that I have in my book show, the Steele dossier was fed by the FBI. So it's it appears that the FBI itself had a hand in writing the dossier.
That's one of the shocking revelations in there. There's always been the Steele dossier. Christopher Steele wrote this thing after doing all of his research and talking to his sources in Russia. But no, the FBI was involved. And Christopher Steele was barely involved.
Steele has a very small role. He was mostly in one of the chapters in the book. I refer to him as the avatar. I mean, he's used to market information to the press and also as cover for the FBI to feed information back into its system.
Is this part of the world intelligence community's sort of mutual back-scratching agreement? If the UK wants to spy on somebody in the UK, they can't do it. So they say, here's a name on an envelope to the CIA who can do it, and then they can wink and nod anything back to them, and vice versa.
Congressman Nunes and his team, while they found that there are different foreign officials who are involved, it appears that the former envoy from Australia to the United Kingdom, Alexander Downer, is involved. There's no evidence yet that foreign intelligence services played a role. Christopher Steele is a former British intelligence officer, and he absolutely played a role. But it appears that there's no evidence right now that foreign intelligence services, active officers really played a role in setting up the Trump campaign. A lot of the stuff that John Brennan has said, for instance, about receiving information from British colleagues or others, I believe this is just cover that Brennan is using. I think it was manufactured by U.S. officials and used by U.S. officials. And it sounds it sounds genuine and authentic if they can say, well, this is came from our friends, our closest allies in London or Canberra. I suspect that looks more like cover than fact.
The Clinton campaign for a long time, they didn't deny it. They were quiet about it. Their involvement in this, they ponied up. They paid for it. They did it through intermediaries, through law firms, through Fusion GPS. Why did they hide the fact that they had commissioned this? If it's a true document,
right,
why would you care if you originated
right.
it?
That's a very good point. They know it's not a true document. They know what it is and the purpose. Something that's very important, though, we have even people highly critical of the Clintons. Over the last couple of years, we focused, and rightly so, on the abuses and likely crimes committed by the FBI, DOJ, different officials at the FBI, DOJ, CIA, Director of National Intelligence. One of the things that's gotten lost, though, is the actual role of the Clinton campaign. It's important to remember, I think, that what happened, the FBI's spying on the Trump campaign, was done to benefit the Clinton campaign, right? This is what's shocking, right? It was a real political operation. The idea that it was an investigation is nonsense. The FBI hid this behind all sorts of programs and instruments that are designed to keep Americans safe from terrorism and from hostile foreign actors. So they used classified information. They used classified counterintelligence programs, confidential human sources, the secret FISA court. That's how they buried what they did. These things were not supposed to talk about. It was a political operation.
But there's no way, just from a layman's point of view, anybody listening has to be thinking, you bring this giant apparatus to bear on behalf of a campaign or directed towards another campaign. There's no way the president of the United States doesn't know about this.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I don't contest that. I mean, there are different, I don't know if I'd call them fingerprints, but there are certainly different traces that we see that I've identified some of them in the book. I think most of your audience is going to recognize the text between Peter Strzok and his paramour, Lisa Page, where she says POTUS wants to know everything we're doing.
Right.
So that's one bit. There are other bits as well. I mean, when that famous Susan Rice email to herself memorializing this January 5th meeting.
President Obama wants everything above board or whatever.
Yes. And that's nonsensical, everything by the book. The real important thing, I think, to take away from that email to herself, Barack Obama says it's important for us to ascertain whether we can share information regarding Russia with the incoming team. Once you strip that of the bureaucratic niceties, all he's saying is collect information on the Trump team about Russia. Ascertain whether we can share information about Russia. So there's Barack Obama talking about collecting from the Trump team or on the Trump team regarding Russia. And we know what happens the day after that meeting. January 6th, then FBI Director James Comey goes to brief President-elect Donald Trump at the Trump Tower. And what's he doing? He's trying to collect information related to Russia on the president-elect.
That's when he briefed him on the dossier.
Exactly.
And then, curiously, it gets reported on CNN.
Strangely.
Because he,
right.
Yeah, I'm sure it was just a coincidence. But the dossier was around for some time. It was being shopped around, not just by the Clinton loyalists. Even John McCain was trying to sort of get somebody interested in this out of nothing more than, I can imagine, as spite. Why was there no biting on it if Hillary wanted this to be a potential October surprise? And there was no doubt that the media was on her side, by and large. Why didn't anybody bite back then?
Well,
because they clearly don't care that the stuff is unverified or proven false. Now they still
report. Right. I mean, a few people did. Right. We have Michael Isikoff from Yahoo News, who wrote about it, David Corn. This was all pre-election.
Yeah, but real journalists.
Kurt Eichenwald.
Again, real journalists.
There were different.
I mean, his octopus or squid porn.
There were different procedures in place, presumably. This is how I like to envision it, that there were different procedures in place so that at what we once believed were prestige press organizations like the New York Times and Washington Post said, well, look, this P tape you're talking about sounds interesting. And they did. I mean, they sent people out to look for it. Mm. So no one just said, sounds ridiculous, forget it. They all sent people out to look for it. Right. And they obviously should have picked up on something. How is this a story of their briefing at least half a dozen other news organizations? Well, it's an operation. Right. If you have a source will give you a story. That's how actual journalism works. Mm-hmm. So they should have said at that point, well, just get these guys out of here and I never want to see them again. But there were different firewalls in place. They couldn't prove it. They couldn't find anything on it. So it wasn't until after that CNN story, which broke down that firewall, and now everyone could report on it once CNN did that story, which circumvented it, right? The CNN story was about the briefing about the dossier.
Right.
So now everyone could report about it.
And then they just throw in the line, we have not yet independently verified anything here.
Right.
But here's wild allegations anyway.
Right.
And they feel as though their bases are covered from a journalistic standpoint. So then Trump is sworn in. Mm-hmm. Devin Nunes starts looking into this, starts sniffing around. And how does he discover all of these unmaskings? And just describe how unprecedented unmasking is and what unmasking is for the few people who don't know.
Right. Well, what happened was in different intercepts that come from, mostly the NSA, comes from different intercepts. The names of U.S. persons are supposed to be minimized. So you're not supposed to see them. Of course, it's not illegal to unmask a name, but you have to have a good reason to do it. There's supposed to be a national security reason for doing it. What the congressman saw was evidence. He was shown evidence by sources that this had happened in an unprecedented fashion. I mean, the numbers were unprecedented.
And especially between the election and inauguration day, it wasn't like over the summer during the campaign.
Right.
Right at the end, suddenly all these unmaskings were taking place.
There were a tremendous amount of Trump officials who were unmasked. And so that got his attention. And one of the points that he made at the time was he saying, it's not about Russia. I believe what he meant about that was that this is not related to what we hear this investigation is about. They were simply finding out what Trump team officials were doing, where they were going. They were just spying on the Trump transition team. That's all they were doing.
One of the things I find most disturbing is there doesn't seem to be a single Democrat who looks at this and says, they violated the rights of someone like a Carter Page. They spied on him.
Right.
Maybe there's a good reason for it, but from a conceptual standpoint, I have a problem with that.
Right.
Did you find anybody behind the scenes involved in all of this this lurking, or has Devin Nunes found anybody behind the scenes in all of this, these moving parts? There's a lot of moving parts to this thing. Is there anybody who was given pause and said, I know what we're doing here.
Right.
Should we be doing it?
Right. On the Democratic side, you
mean? Yes.
No. And this is it truly is shocking. I absolutely agree, and I'll make it even a little larger. You would think that someone at some point, some Democrat at some point, would say, "Well, look, I don't like Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. I like Donald Trump less than any of you here combined." But this whole thing with Russia, it's nonsense. I know it's nonsense. We all know it's nonsense because we talk about how it's nonsense in the cloakroom or wherever we Democrats hang out. So let's put this aside because it's not great for the party. We look like obscurantist lunatics, and it's terrible for the country because it's eating the country apart. And you see what these leaks are doing to the press. we're losing the media. The media is turning into a third world media. So let's put this aside and let's fight Donald Trump in the normal ways and get back to politics and argue about the things that we should be arguing about. Did anyone do that? No one did it. It's not even as refined about like, I am worried about this. There are, I should say, though, press people who did it. And they had a much harder time than you and me. These are people from the left. So we're talking about people like Glenn Greenwald,
right?
Aaron Maté, who writes often for The Nation. Aaron has been doing fantastic work on this. So there are journalists who have taken this on. Matt Taibbi. These are people more regularly associated with the left. But their work on this has been terrific. And again, for them to stand against the left and call them out, say, hey, Rachel Maddow, you're a lunatic and you're full of it. So they deserve a tremendous amount of credit for standing up.
Even
if
you do it from a self-preservation standpoint, say, if we do this, if we get away with it, then it can be done to us.
Right.
You know, even if you just look at it from that point and not even a civil libertarian point of view, it's from a mutually assured destruction point of view, you would think it would occur to somebody and say, maybe we don't have to wholeheartedly embrace this while still pursuing it, I don't think.
Right.
Now, as we get close to the end here, Lee Smith, I know how writing a book works. The journalism aspect is something I'm not familiar with. My book was not a journalistic exercise. But when you set out to write this, mm-hmm. I assume you had a notion in your mind, an outline in your mind. What in the course of it, in doing all the research that you did and writing it and talking to the people that you did you ever have a holy crap moment? I had no idea it was this far, or it was this bad, or I'm shocked by this thing that I've uncovered.
That's a little difficult to talk about because all of us have been living with this for 3 years. So at a certain point, you can't, I mean, that's why right now, why the impeachment thing, if we were to have an American, say a Rip Van Winkle who had fallen asleep, he fell asleep sometime in 2014 and woke up now, like, what is going on? But all of us who have lived through Russiagate, we now see impeachment. It's like, well, it makes total sense. Of course, we have the transcript here to show what President Trump really said compared to this nonsensical whistleblower's complaint that reads like a Washington Post op-ed.
Right.
But
written by a team of lawyers.
Exactly. But we've all become so accustomed to this now. Unfortunately, we're in a place where what's shocking is to see the thing as a whole, to see how bad things have gotten. So it's not one thing, but again, it's the larger structure of what's happened here.
We're going to continue to learn more about this, obviously, but do you think there will ever be any semblance of what a normal person would consider justice?
Congressman Nunes has spoken about two things since he and I have been speaking for, about 2 years. He said two important things are, first is there has to be an accounting, and the book is part of the accounting of what really happened. The other is accountability, and that the only people who can do that are at the Department of Justice. I'm optimistic that the Attorney General Barr, and the man who's investigating everything that happened, U.S. Attorney John Durham, I know that they're serious people, and I'm optimistic that justice will be done. It's very hard to imagine how we move on from this moment if justice is not done.
Lastly, Lee Smith, when somebody closes the last page, they've read this whole thing. They sit down, cup of coffee, bottle of beer, bottle of scotch, read it straight through, going in blind. What do you want them? What do you want their thought to be when they close that back cover?
To understand what happened, really, just to see what happened, the depths of it. And again, there's a lot we still don't know. And this is what we hope Mr. Durham will be finding. And there'll be stuff that we'll be finding for many years, even after his investigation is wrapped up. The most important thing for me is that really that people understand what these rogue officials did in our intelligence community. I want them to understand that. And I also want them to understand what Congressman Nunes and his team did. That's the most important thing. And then if people want to get angry, yeah, or if they want to get sad, or if they want to find some way to assist, I don't know. But again, the most important thing is just understand clarity. That's it.
Well, Lord knows there are enough people out there reading this book. Number one on Amazon for its first week.
It's amazing.
Congratulations on the success. The Plot Against the President, the true story of how Congressman Devin Nunes uncovered the biggest political scandal in U.S. history. Lee, congratulations.
Sure,
thank you for coming
much.
In.
Thanks. It's great
Go
to be here.
Buy it now and then enjoy your weekend. See you later.
Thank
Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks.